Tantal Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Alternative History of Britain, Normans and Early Plantagenets, by Timothy Venning, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Chapter 1. The Norman State. The unlikely succession of Henry I. What if his older brothers, Robert or Richard, had ruled? And did he murder William II? The succession to England from 1087 to 1154 owed a lot to fortuitous circumstances, in that it was unusual for Western Europe, where the major states more often descended through a father-eldest-son line, most notably in France, which did not deviate once from this between Hugh I's accession in 987 and John I's death in 1316. The Holy Roman Empire descended more obliquely, but it was prey to the ambitions of competing families and was not a geographically compact block of inherited lands. The problem of female succession that afflicted England after Henry I's only son's death in 1120 was not apparent in Castile, where Alfonso VI's son also died unexpectedly in battle, and his daughter, Urraca, was able to succeed in 1109, as did Baldwin II's eldest daughter, Melisande, in the Kingdom of Jerusalem in 1131. The county, later Kingdom of Portugal, a minor part of Alfonso's realm, was inherited by his other, illegitimate daughter, Teresa, and her husband. Those states ruled by a king that had irregular succession were unusually due to civil war or repeated rebellion among a number of rival lines descended from the sons of one dominant ancestor, as in Denmark after 1134, the line of Sven Estrithson, and Norway after 1130, the line of Magnus Bareleg. A similar fate befell the weaker duchy Kingdom of Bohemia, while in the northeast of Europe, Poland after 1138 and Russia after 1054 remained technically one state, but were in reality divided up into rival sub-states over which one senior ruler might from time to time have an honorary primacy. The divided inheritance of 1087, not the norm for the era in Western Europe. The division of an expansionist ruler's lands among his sons on his death, on William I's death in 1087 in England, had a parallel thrice in Spain, where Ferdinand I, younger son of the King of Navarre, had inherited Castile from his mother in 1035 and taken over his wife's brother Vermudo's León by conquest in 1037. Ferdinand's father, Sancho the Great of Navarre, had already divided his own lands among three sons, Navarre for one, Castile for a second, and Aragon for the third. On Ferdinand I's death in 1065, his united kingdom of Castile and León was divided between his sons Sancho and Alfonso, but the former disinherited the latter and was murdered, enabling his victim to take over both kingdoms, 1072, an approximate parallel with the fratricidal jealousy and possible fratricide among William I's sons. Alfonso VI passed on the reunited kingdom to his daughter Urraca and grandson Alfonso VII. But when the latter died in 1157, it was divided between two sons, Sancho and Ferdinand again. Dividing up the late ruler's lands among his sons was not standard legal tradition in William's homeland of northern France in the 11th and 12th centuries, with the king's Ile-de-France patrimony and lesser dukes and counts' dominions usually going to the eldest son. The question of what to do with conquered lands did not usually apply, as the political order was relatively stable. The only repeated division within one family was of the counties of Blois and Champagne, which were not geographically contiguous anyway. Normally, the younger sons could expect at best a minor sub-state that could not militarily rival their elders' lands, as with the lands given to younger sons of the kings of France or counts of Anjou. The largest block of lands, with the senior title, went to the oldest son, unless he was incapable or a cleric, as for example with future King Stephen's oldest brother in Blois, William, who, according to historian William of Newburgh, was set aside by his mother due to deficiency in intelligence. More often a younger son had to fend for himself and find an heiress, as future King Stephen, third or fourth son of Count Stephen of Blois, did with the County of Boulogne's heiress, Matilda. He then received the County of Mortain in Normandy from his mother's brother, Henry I of England and Normandy. Normandy had never been divided on the occasions when a duke had two sons. For example, William I's father and uncle in 1026, when the new Duke Robert set up his younger brother Henry, the future king, in the Cotentin, there as a powerful vassal, circa 1090, this was probably forced by Henry rather than voluntary generosity. Scandinavian kingdoms were divided at times, but between co-kings, with one usually senior. For example, Harald Hardrada's sons in 1066, and the sons of Magnus Bareleg in 1103. The Normans' other dominions in southern Italy passed from one son of Tancred de Hauteville to another in the 1040s and 1050s, rather than being divided, although this was due to pragmatism. A united state was needed to fight its many foes, and the count, duke, could not trust his brothers with many states of their own, and this new state lacked tradition. When Sicily was conquered by the family of Tancred in the late 1060s, it became a separate state under the younger brother, Roger, of the current Duke Robert Guiscard, for military efficiency in an ongoing war against the Arabs, as much as out of Roger's rights. Guiscard notably disinherited his elder son, Bohemond, his most promising general and the likelier candidate to win the militaristic nobles' backing, from his mainland duchy in favour of his younger son, Roger Borsa, and let him inherit only a minor county, Taranto. That incident, in 1085, so fresh in people's memories when William I died, was not, however, an exact parallel. The two young men had different mothers, and Roger's was a local Lombard heiress, the warlike Sicilgaita, who took part in battles, so the area's Lombards would obey him sooner than Bohemond. The latter, like Robert of Normandy in 1087, attempted to reverse the grant of a large estate to his younger brother by war, but did not have the military resources to do so, and had to give up. He consoled himself with the Duchy of Antioch when the First Crusade commenced, and later made a bold bid to take over the entire Byzantine Empire, 1107. Bohemond and Robert of Normandy, indeed, served as colleagues on the Crusade, where Robert showed that he did not lack military competence or bravery. Normandy's neighbouring North French states in Flanders, Maine, Anjou, and Brittany, the latter Celtic by genetic origin and culture, not French, usually descended as one polity, from father to son, or from brother to brother, but were occasionally seized by a disgruntled relative in revolts. In the Scandinavian world, from which the Normans' ancestors had come to France in the 900s, a divided inheritance was only common in the Jarldom of Orkney, held by the distant cousins of the Dukes of Normandy. The founding Duke Rollo Hrolf the Walker, allegedly too fat to ride a horse, had been son of Jarl Rognvald of More in Norway. But there the sons of a deceased Jarl usually shared the small state out equally, rather than having one as the dominant ruler, though the eldest was usually senior. Natural death, or more usually, fratricide, duly elevated one contender to sole rule. There was one example of a youngest son in a seemingly hopeless situation triumphing as Henry I of England did by luck and his wits, namely Jarl Thorfinn Ravenfeeder, reigned 1015 to circa 1065, who had outwitted and outlived his feuding elder brothers and nephews. But there is no evidence of any influence of Viking Orkney dynastic practice on the Frankified Norman state. There was thus no decisive precedent for William to divide Normandy and England between two sons, except the geographical difficulty of ruling both at once, and the likely anger of the second surviving son if disinherited. He technically left England to God, as he had received it from him. But by giving his second surviving son, William, the crown, and telling him to go and take it, he expressed a clear preference for his succession. He had held both states himself since 1066, rather than passing on Normandy to Robert once the latter was adult, which Robert may have resented given his rebellion in 1077 when he was aged in his mid-twenties. The King of France seems to have encouraged him in order to split up William's dominions and make Robert his dependent protégé. Nor was a division of England itself in 1087 likely, though England was not a long-established unitary kingdom, unlike hindsight can suggest. Local particularism and a possible threat of a breakaway state were involved in the claims of King Harald Hardrada of Norway on Scandinavian-settled York in 1066, which had benefited William by drawing Harald II away from the south coast to fight off this invasion. Sven Estrithson of Denmark, nephew of King Canute of England and Denmark, attacked York on his own initiative in 1070, with some local support. Whether he aimed for rule of just York or all England is unclear. York had last been a separate state in 954, under ex-king Eric Bloodaxe of Norway. 11th century English tradition played up in William's claims to be preserving the legal practices of the reign of King Edward was in favour of a unified realm in recent decades. England had been divided among rival contenders once in the 11th century, but only in the temporary case of a military stalemate between Edmund Ironside and Canute in 1016. The feuding sons of Canute in 1035-36 had failed to agree on any division after their father's death. All had gone to the nearest at hand, Harald Harefoot and the loser, Harthacnut Canute's mother and faction leader Queen Emma. William's great-aunt had been driven out. The 10th century precedence for two sons of a deceased king ruling different parts of England, probably Elfweard and Athelstan in 924, and certainly Edwy and Edgar in 957, would have been a distant memory for the English administrative class that served William after 1066, if recalled at all. In any case, the pragmatic William was hardly likely to divide up a hard-won unitary state, racked by rebellion in 1067-71, among two potentially feuding sons, or even give a substantial landed endowment to the third, Henry. William had made a point of confiscating the lands of any of his intimates, related or not, who posed a security risk, such as his half-brother Bishop Odo, Earl of Kent, in 1083. He had carefully reduced the number of great lords who had a block of territory in one area, which could be used as a centre of rebellion, as Odo's Kent could have been used as a landing site for an attack on England by a would-be usurper such as Robert. The creation of a contiguous block of territory for one man was mostly restricted to the border areas where this was needed to lead defence. For example, the earldoms of Hereford and Montgomery in the Welsh Marches, both of whose holders rebelled in 1075 and 1101, and the northeast in 1067-70, where his earls of Northumbria repeatedly rebelled or overthrown. The use of his personal trustees for these fiefs was not a guarantee of long-term loyalty, as he had given Hereford to his foster-brother, William FitzOsborne, 1067, to face revolt once the latter's son succeeded, 1075, and Odo of Kent, deposed 1083, was his half-brother. If he could not trust these men to be loyal to him, he could not trust his younger sons to be loyal to the latter's elder brother. William was hardly likely to create a new block of English land in 1087 for a younger son, for example, Henry within William II's realm, after the threat that Odo's block had posed. The most that can be said is that if Henry's mother, Queen Matilda, a would-be peacemaker among the feuding youths in the 1070s, had not died in 1083, she might have persuaded her husband to increase Henry's legacy from money to a larger grant of land in England than he actually received. Dividing England and Normandy was more logical, but also problematic. Giving one state to each of his two older sons would increase the chance of them fighting, as each had enough resources for a prolonged war. The King of France, Philip I, was likely to encourage them to fight each other to weaken the dynasty's threat to his own domains next door in the Ile de France, as he had backed Robert against William I in 1077, and as feudal overlord of Normandy, he could declare the duchy forfeit, though this could be ignored by a strong ruler. It was safer to give a younger, or disinherited elder, son, a smaller inheritance with which he could not mount a military challenge, and in this regard, William did not leave his youngest son Henry any compact block of land. He received Queen Matilda's scattered lands in the South Midlands, plus £5,000. William's decision was hardly due to a sudden desire for justice for all his sons as part of repenting for his past sins as he was dying, as he carefully prevented Henry from having enough resources to challenge the two older sons. He could, however, have left both states to his elder son, Robert, and a militarily powerless small district to the younger William. If Orderic Vitalis' stories about his wrath towards the treacherous and rebellious Robert in the late 1070s are correct, he was capable of disinheriting him in William Rufus' favour, unless he was constrained by the promises he had made to the late Queen Matilda, circa 1080, to pardon Robert. Matilda had apparently regarded Robert as her favourite, sent him money when he was living in exile after 1077, to her husband's annoyance, and successfully interceded for his restoration to favour after the rebellion. If Orderic is to be believed, William I had openly made belittling jokes about his eldest son's small stature before the revolt, which indicates contempt rather than confidence in him as a future ruler. Robert was also mocked for his pot belly and had a string of concubines. Another of Orderic's possibly apocryphal stories has Robert driven to revolt in 1077 by being humiliated in front of his friends when his brothers William Rufus and Henry poured water, if not worse, on him from a balcony with equal contempt. If any of this is true, Henry was only 8 or 9 at the time. Robert was perceived as an easy target for teasing by his father and brothers, which may have undermined his confidence to hold down his future subjects by force. Did this mutual dislike between father and son make it more likely that William would give England to one of Robert's younger brothers? And did he do this as he thought Robert was not up to the job of ruling such a large state? Or would Robert have stood a chance of gaining England if he had been in Normandy and reconciled to William at the time the latter did? He was currently in exile again, in neighbouring Ponthieu, after another row, and William's death, at the age of probably 58 or 9, was unexpected. It followed him rupturing his stomach against the pommel of his horse when the latter stumbled as the king was sacking the rebel vexin town of Mont, a rebellion backed by Robert's ally, King Philip of France. That circumstance was not likely to encourage the hot-tempered William to forgive Robert and give him England. But if the accident had not intervened, Robert might well have had more difficulty in acquiring a pardon from his father after 1087 than he had done after 1077, without Matilda to aid him. Thus William I could have disinherited his exiled heir, at least from England, had he died naturally in the 1090s. The quarrels over William I's inheritance, an unlikely chain of events. In the first instance, although William I's apparent plans for the succession were adhered to initially, the eldest son, Robert, having his paternal ancestor's patrimony of Normandy, and the next surviving one, William II, England, the succession of Henry I to England in 1100 and his seizure of Normandy in 1106 were unexpected. William Rufus saw off his elder brother's attempts to take over England in 1088, although both of their half-uncles, Odo, restored to Kent by William I's will, and Count Robert of Mortain, backed Robert of Normandy. Indeed, the latter had the strategic advantage that Odo could raise his vassals in Kent to give him a port there, and Count Robert could offer him access to England via his castle of Pevensey, adjacent to William I's landing site in 1066. But a mixture of bad weather and lack of money meant that Duke Robert could not muster a fleet quickly. He had to sell the Cotentin in western Normandy to Henry for ready cash, and William II blockaded the rebels' castles into surrender as they waited in vain for Robert to arrive to aid them. Thus, William I's settlement was not overturned, and Robert's reputation for bad luck, or slackness, was begun or reinforced. But William II did not settle the succession by marrying quickly and providing a son, though Robert did not either. Their father had married in his early 20s. Robert did not marry until he was nearly 50. William II remained unmarried for whatever reason, despite apparent interest in the niece of Edgar, Atheling, and the daughter of Malcolm III and Margaret, Edith Matilda, then living at Wilton Convent in the 1090s. Over a decade younger than him, she had come south from her parents' court to be educated by her aunt Christina, allegedly a hard taskmaster, at Romsey Abbey in 1086, and had moved on to the less austere Wilton, which was effectively a school for noble girls. She had been betrothed to Count Alan of Richmond, premier baron of the North Riding of Yorkshire, but he had run off with her fellow pupil Gunhilda, a daughter of King Harold II. The fact that she had been forced to wear a nun's veil by her aunt, who wanted her to become a nun, later presented a legal problem for Henry I in marrying her in 1100, as this could amount to taking preliminary monastic vows. But that would not stop the irreligious William, who delighted in shocking clerics. She was able to argue convincingly when objections were raised to her marrying Henry after wearing a nun's habit that she had been forced to wear it by her aunt when under the age of normal consent to becoming a nun. Indeed, in legal terms, the number of Saxon heiresses hiding from heiress-hunting Norman lords in convents after 1066 and wearing habits to discourage their pursuers led to careful consideration of the whole issue of what exactly constituted taking irrevocable holy orders. It was decided that consent at an adult age was essential to make it legal, and Edith Matilda had not been adult. She was born circa 1074-78, or consenting. The same argument would have been used had William II chosen her as a wife. However, Henry, and clearly Edith too, had an added advantage over the marriage that William would not have done. In 1093, the confident and uncompromising new Archbishop Anselm had insisted that Edith had taken vows and should stay in the cloister. In 1100, he had spent years in exile and was anxious to cooperate with Henry after his recall. William was rumoured to be homosexual, according to church chroniclers, to which the effeminate conduct of his young aristocratic supporters at court, with their long hair and trailing cloaks, gave credence. This may only be a slanderous inference by his enemies or opponents of their fashions. Short hair was the fashion of William I's elite, as shown by the Bayeux tapestry. His brusque treatment and eventual exile of his belatedly appointed Archbishop of Canterbury, St. Anselm, ensured that the latter's hagiographers would be hostile. Indeed, his mysterious and violent death, without time to confess his sins, showed eager church critics after 1100 that God had repaid his blasphemous behaviour as he deserved and made any slander seem believable. William was at most 44, probably only 40 when he died, although most adult male rulers had acquired a wife or bastards much earlier. Diplomacy and acquiring useful foreign allies by matrimony usually impelled a royal marriage, and it may be that the king saw no need of this in the 1090s. He seems to have had at least one bastard son in the 1080s, though fewer than either of his brothers had. Henry was notorious for his mistresses, and could use his illegitimate children as political pawns, the more promising sons being given lordships, and the daughters married off to political allies. William I had himself been illegitimate, as his enemies reminded him. But William II seems to have been careless of this potential usefulness of having children out of wedlock, unlike the calculating Henry. Possibly he was more fastidious, or possibly he preferred male comradeship without being much of a womaniser or being homosexual. Until he was regent of Normandy for Robert in 1096 to 1100, he had no need of continental entanglement, the obvious reason for acquiring a wife. Robert was also unmarried in his 40s, although he had been due to marry in his father's lifetime until his fiancée died. The ongoing crisis in Scotland after Malcolm III was killed, attacking Alnwick Castle in autumn 1093, led to William interfering to back the part English, Saxon, not Norman, claimant Edgar, fourth son of Malcolm and St Margaret, against the isolationist incumbent Donald Ban, his uncle, in 1097. This expedition, entrusted to Edgar's uncle and namesake, the Atheling, and assorted ambitious Anglo-Norman volunteers, placed the friendly Edgar on the Scots throne as an English client, and was thus an obvious occasion for William to marry his sister, Edith Matilda, usefully available at Romsey, then Wilton. As has been mentioned, he had already been to inspect her. The fact that he did not proceed with any marriage may suggest carelessness about hurrying to do something distasteful, rather than any sexual reason. He had not bothered to appoint an Archbishop of Canterbury for 4 years after Lanfranc died, finding the see's revenues useful for his treasury. Allegedly homosexual kings married for state reasons. Edward II was to marry Isabella of France and have 4 children, while emotionally entangled with Piers Gaveston in the 1300s. If anything can be read into William's reluctance to marry and beget an heir, apart from carelessness, it may have been the lack of an obvious candidate, and he had no urgent state reasons to provide an heir. When he and Robert came to an agreement in 1091, it was proposed that the surviving brother have the other's dominions on his death, excluding their younger brother Henry. His carelessness about taking politically sensible action was evident in other areas, as when he rudely ignored the visiting Malcolm III of Scots at his autumn crown wearing in Gloucester in 1093 and caused him to invade England in a rage. If this had not happened, not only Malcolm, then probably over 60, but his eldest son by St Margaret, Edward, would not have been killed in the invasion at Alnwick, and presumably Edward would have inherited Scotland. That would not have prevented any rebellions, and thus an English intervention in Scotland. However, traditional Celtic, Gallic, Scots inheritance laws favoured the succession of a younger brother, rather than a son. So Malcolm's younger brother, Donald Ban, was likely to have challenged Edward. There was also the question of Malcolm's son by his first Orkney marriage, seemingly disinherited in the 1070s to 80s, by being held as a hostage in England, Duncan II. In real life, William II used him to challenge and overthrow Donald, temporarily in 1094. But if Malcolm's son Edward had been an Anglophile king in the mid-late 1090s or 1100s, this would not have been necessary. William took charge of Normandy while Robert was absent on the First Crusade in 1096 to 1100, and the latter was returning to Normandy with his new wife, Sybil of Conversano, when William was suddenly killed hunting on the 2nd of August 1100. The timing of the accident, as modern historians have commented, was seemingly useful for Henry. Henry's prospects of taking over England would have been reduced once Robert returned and had a son to continue the Norman ducal line, unless William fell out with his elder brother again and left England to Henry to spite Robert. The existence of an extra heir for Robert's line was not, however, decisive, as the choice of king or duke lay with the magnates, and the Norman barons had rejected Duke Richard III's infant son for the adult Robert the Magnificent, William I's father, in 1035. The pre-1066 English precedents for sidestepping an underage heir mattered less, as their lay and ecclesiastical magnates had been removed from power. Henry's swift seizure of power on William II's death, he rode straight for Winchester and the Treasury, gave him the opportunity to defy Robert's inevitable attempt to invade England in 1101, and in due course, to take over Normandy too. Had William had an Archbishop of Canterbury in situ, not in exile in 1100, and that man backed Robert, his refusal to crown Henry could have been crucial. The exiled incumbent, Anselm, was a man of strict principle and unlikely to have been intimidated by Henry into breaking an oath to accept Robert as William II's heir. though Henry could have made another cleric crown him as the Archbishop of Canterbury did not always crown the 11th century kings of England. The Archbishop of York had crowned Harold II and William I. Seemingly abler than Robert at controlling the turbulent barons, Henry has been seen as a stronger king than Robert would have been had the latter returned to Normandy with William still alive and had succeeded him later. There have been recent attempts to rehabilitate Robert, arguing that the turbulent state of Normandy after 1087 owed much to factors beyond Robert's control, especially the existence of a troublemaking rival able to stir up revolt and receive exiles, and even their ferocious father had faced minor revolt in 1077-79. If a neighbouring ruler, King Philip of France in 1077, William after 1087, was stirring up revolt, was any Norman ruler, however fierce, safe? By contrast, after 1106, Henry faced no rival in Normandy until his eldest brother's son, William Clito, was an adult in the late 1110s, when revolt broke out again. Henry also faced revolt from disaffected magnates in 1101 to 1103, as William in England and Robert in Normandy had done, though arguably any new ruler, combatant and ferocious or not, faced revolt if a rival was available. Dissatisfied baronial chancers were always ready to strike at a time of uncertainty, hence the usual 11th and 12th century occurrence of a ruler's death, causing nervous magnates to hurry home and await disorder from a safe, fortified residence. So is it unfair to present the assorted revolts in Robert's Normandy as evidence of his weakness? But the fact remains that Robert's Norman nobles felt able to defy his authority in 1087-97 and 1100-1106, unlike they did to William I in 1053-77, or Henry I after 1106. Both men faced major challenges from defiant local magnates on their accession, and William, aged 7 or 8 at the time, in 1035, could not stop the anarchy of his minority unless he was old enough to fight. But once they had made examples of leading offenders, their realms quietened down quickly. Both made a point of mutilating opponents. William notoriously did so to insolent rebel townsmen who had hung out tanners' hides on their walls as a jibe at his mother's lowly origins. But Henry mutilated a few nobles too. Among the victims of one blinding of hostages were two of Henry's own granddaughters, handed over by the king to a noble whose son had been blinded by their father. The girl's mother, his illegitimate daughter Juliana, then tried to shoot him with a crossbow, but missed. Mutilation was seen as perfectly acceptable by contemporary standards, and by not killing the victims, it gave them time to repent of their sins and so enter heaven. Both men also held their most dangerous state prisoners for many years, William's including Harold's brother, Wulfnoth, for over 35 years, and Earl Morcar and Henry's, including Robert himself, for 28 years. The anti-Robert disaffection did not halt after the early successes of his ducal reign, 1088-91, and it cannot be put down solely to his having two troublemaking brothers ready to aid rebels, Henry within and William Rufus outside Normandy. Both men may have been less pleasant individuals than Robert, but their known ferocity and killings and mutilations of enemies served to keep their Norman barons in line, and Robert failed to do so. Ruling an 11th or 12th century state was not a popularity contest, and a sovereign had to be feared to secure order. The nearest equivalent to Robert's Normandy in terms of regular turbulence was Brittany, but the latter had no such tradition of long-term central control, and its provincial decentralisation into semi-autonomous districts run by ancient families was far older. Ducal control from Rennes by a strong ruler had only re-emerged in the 10th century after expulsion of the Vikings, lapsed at times, and was the exception rather than the norm. There was regular defiance of central control by minor local lords in the late 11th and early 12th century, Ile-de-France, but there, Louis VI, as heir and as king, warred ceaselessly against it, unlike Robert did. Henry's scoffing claim after he took over Normandy that Robert could not keep order in his own household, let alone in his duchy, may have been opportunist, but was hardly likely just to have been invented by Robert's detractors to please Henry. Nor was the claim that Robert's wife, Sybil of Conversano, who died inopportunely in 1103, was a more capable ruler than him. It is not a sufficient argument to allege that Robert had unique problems in Normandy from his accession in 1087 and return in 1100, in that rebels knew they could count on his ambitious brothers for help. The same could be said of William II in 1088 and Henry in 1100 to 1102, and they both faced down their challenges successfully. The argument of a revisionary interest encouraging rebellion applies equally to William I, threatened in Normandy by his eldest son in 1077, and Henry, faced by his nephew, William Clito, in the early 1120s. The former could put down the 1077 revolt despite the setbacks of defeat and personal worsting in combat by his son at Jerboa, and the latter never faced the same level of anarchy from William Clito's faction as Robert did from his enemies. Both also had to contend with a hostile King of France backing rebels and fugitives. The most that can be said for Robert is that the victory of his rival Henry in 1106 made it certain that the latter would ensure that history was written by the winners and that his rule of Normandy would be presented by pro-Henry writers as anarchic. English or Anglo-French writers, such as Eadmer and Orderic Vitalis, also had the obvious contrast between a well-ordered England, good, and a turbulent Normandy, bad, to draw on, with weak governance of the latter the obvious reason for it. Robert was a brave warrior and an adequate commander, as seen by his actions on the First Crusade, but did he have enough energy in controlling his barons? He could be defended more convincingly if he had the reputation for tireless aggression towards defiance that Louis VI did. William I might nevertheless have named Robert as his heir to England as well as Normandy. It is not certain that feudal law was coherent enough by 1087 to make it necessary for the paternal inheritance to go to the eldest son, and the conquests to younger ones. But did feudal law apply to the inheritance of crown states as well as ordinary landed possessions? As we have learned, there are no parallels with other states in France, and the lands divided among several sons in 11th and 12th century Spain had been inherited, not conquered. Indeed, the situation as of 1087 was not that of the early years of William I's reign. Until his mysterious death in a hunting accident in the New Forest, circa 1074, William's second surviving son was not Rufus, but his elder brother Richard, born circa 1054 to 56. Had he not been killed, he was also ahead of Henry in the succession stakes. There is no indication of Richard's capacity, and he was probably killed while still in his teens, though later stories written with hindsight have implied that he was capable and chivalrous. It appears that while Richard was alive, William Rufus was being educated at a rather advanced academic level for a secular ruler by Archbishop Lanfranc, which may indicate an intention for him to enter the church. One source claimed that he took preliminary holy orders as an oblate, and it is not impossible that his father intended him to take over the role of the family's episcopal strongman, keeping the church friendly from Bishop Odo. But it is unclear if there was any such intention, or if it ended with Richard's fatal accident. Henry's reputation for being bookish and erudite, deriving from William of Malmesbury, was once seen as implying that Henry Buchler had new modern concepts of the monarchy's administrative role that William I and II did not. It has been downplayed by modern research. Robert as ruler of England after 1087. The turbulence in Normandy under Robert gives a fair guide to what he would have been like as King of England with the caveat that the king had more resources to deal with rebellion easier than had a Duke of Normandy, whose rebels could always retreat across the border into the Ile de France and launch raids, as Robert himself had done in 1077. The possession of more central resources in England than in Normandy would have helped Robert to keep rebellion at bay if he could satisfy or marginalise William, Rufus and Henry. But can any parallels be drawn between his character and what it might have implied for England and the real-life defiance that met the equally courageous but lackadaisical Stephen after 1135? The latter faced repeated defiance and defections from 1136, which he failed to halt by decisive action, most notably by not capturing his challenger Matilda at Arundel in 1139. If Robert had faced one or two brothers stirring up trouble, would he have fared any better than Stephen did? The likeliest places for open defiance of the king would have been the more compact and larger lordships far from London, the marcher lands on the Welsh borders, where the ambitious lords acquired new lands and tenants in occupied parts of South, Central and North Wales, Difford, Brecon and Radnor, and Clwyd, in the late 1080s and early 1090s, and the Scots borders. Their distance from Winchester and London meant that royal visits there to check up on and overawe the great barons were rare, and even under the ferocious William I, there was a major marcher plot in 1075. The active and successful William II, who had already seen off the most serious potential threat to unseat him in 1088, faced a Northumbrian revolt in 1093. A less energetic or feared Robert would have been likely to face either revolt or a slipping away of his authority to local magnates, unless his centrally appointed sheriffs could contain this. The capable administrator, Archbishop Lanfranc, died in 1089, so he would have needed a viable replacement, though he might well not have kept the archbishopric vacant and used its fiscal resources for as long as the anti-religious William II did to 1093. Robert's reign, he died in 1134, aged over 80, would probably have seen blatant defiance of the king by powerful individuals and groups of lords, as under Stephen, and possibly also a revolt in William's or Henry's favour. Younger brothers resenting their lack of power were a perennial nuisance to monarchs, as faced by Richard I as late as 1190 to 94, and if King Robert had departed on crusade in 1096, he would have had to decide whether to allow William and Henry to stay behind as regent or to insist that they accompany him. As with Richard I in 1190 to 94, leaving an ambitious brother in England or Normandy would run the risk of rebellion. But Robert, unlike William II, seems to have had no major problems with the church for alleged contempt of their mores, and was backed in real life 1088 to 89 by his uncle, Bishop Odo. The ruthless Earl Bishop, who had fought at Hastings, would have made a good regent for England during the Crusade if Robert could not rely on his brothers. In real life, he was by then living in Normandy after William II drove him out of England, and he accompanied Robert on Crusade and died in Sicily. Another potential episcopal regent was the able and extortionate Ranulf Flambard, Bishop of Durham, and treasurer to William II and likely to have worked for Robert too, had he been king. Like Richard I's extortionate episcopal regent, William Longchamp, in 1190-91, he could easily have faced a baronial revolt once his master had left England. Murder or accident? The events of the 2nd of August, 1100. The useful timing of William's violent death has led to accusations that Henry and or his adherents planned it. The supposed firer of the arrow that killed William by accident on the 2nd of August, 1100, one of his hunting party called Walter Tyrrell, fled the scene. But he had every reason to flee, even if innocent. Henry was capable of killing him as a scapegoat, particularly given the number of Henry's friends among the hunting party, assorted de Clares and Robert FitzHamon. Tyrrell could have been, or feared that he would be, framed for a killing done by Henry's men. He was still denying that he had shot the king years later on his deathbed, He even denied that he had been in that part of the New Forest at the time, while the party in attendance on the king included a number of men, for example Fitzhamon, given the lordship of Glamorgan, and the de Clares of Tunbridge, who Henry was to reward as his close allies as king. That has led to modern claims that these men could have arranged the killing to do him a favour, with Prince Louis of France an alternative choice as a man who would have been glad to have the aggressive king out of the way and replaced by a conflict between Henry and Robert. Tyrrell, married to a de Clare, could have collaborated with them to kill William, and Emma Mason has suggested that his possession of the castellanship of the French town of Pontoise on the Norman border in the gift of the French king, and friendship with Prince Louis was suspicious. According to one chronicler, Geoffrey Gaimard, he was asking William about the route of his forthcoming campaign in northern France before the killing. Was this spying for Louis, and did that extend to regicide? William had been showing recent interest in expanding his interests in the Duchy of Aquitaine, acting as regent while the Duke was on crusade, which could give him the resources to challenge the King of France. The convenient timing of claims that William was warned by a monk on the day of the killing that he had had a dream portending his death, involving an arrow, is not reliable evidence of a plot. This could be coincidence or later gossip. The portents allegedly seen before the accident, such as a lake of blood and other dreams hinting at imminent divine vengeance on the blaspheming, church-despoiling king, were a common contemporary phenomenon around the time of a major disaster. Nature was supposed to reflect important politico-religious crises, and stories to confirm this were collected eagerly by the impressionable. No value can be placed on a story that William allegedly gave Tyrrell an arrow on the day of the accident and told him to see that justice was done. If the detail was remembered accurately, he was presumably referring to justice on the deer, and it was an irony that the king was the one who was killed. The site of the king's residence, which he left that morning to hunt, is unknown, and the 19th century suggestion, Castle Malwood, taken up by the novelist Charles Kingsley, was not even a hunting lodge at the time. The forest had only been taken over for hunting as a royal game preserve in the 1070s, and the later main royal hunting lodge at Lyndhurst may not have been built. The largest local settlement in the Domesday Book, which probably had a royal hall, was Brockenhurst. Indeed, the site of the killing is still uncertain, despite a definitive identification using local stories when the Rufus Stone was set up near Stony Cross in the north of the forest in 1745. An alternative site has been suggested, far to the south near Bewley, and the site of the killing was supposed to have been near that of a demolished church, and there were no settlements at Stony Cross. Any reconstruction of the events is thus futile. The exact circumstances of the king's killing have to be taken at the word of those at the scene, who subsequently backed Henry as his successor, and according to them, William stepped into the line of shot of another hunter as a stag passed, with the setting sun dazzling them. By the usual custom, William, as host, should have had the sole shot at this first deer, but perhaps he had conceded this to a comrade. It thus remains possible that one of Henry's men shot the king, possibly using one of Tyrrell's arrows, purloined, and then showing this as evidence that Tyrrell had done the deed, and the sources agree that the hunting party dispersed in panic to protect their lands from a possible civil war, rather than staying to hold an investigation. But this is only a plausible scenario, and it would mean that Henry was prepared to gamble on surviving attack once Robert returned to Normandy in a few months' time. Whatever the truth behind the shooting, it must have seemed unlikely as of the 1st of August 1100, that both the king, aged between 40 and 44, and his elder brother would be superseded by Henry. If there had been no accident, or Henry had not gambled on fratricide, then the chances are that either William or Henry would have been trying to remove Robert from his dukedom again within a few years. William was an ambitious and restless man, who was prepared to become involved with faraway Aquitaine to expand his interests, and Normandy would have remained a tempting target, particularly if disorder continued there after 1100, as it did in real life. Whether it was a weak Robert to blame, or a meddling Henry of England or Philip of France, or Philip's son Louis, encouraging dissidents, barons continued to defy Robert until Henry finally invaded and deposed him. The same temptation may have seemed irresistible to William, encouraged by Henry, but William is unlikely to have given Henry any major power within Normandy once he took over, lest his brother try to seize the entire duchy. With Scotland ruled by an ally from 1097, the other main target for an expansionist William within mainland Britain would have been Wales, where much of lowland Gwynedd had been conquered by his vassals, led by the Earls of Chester and Montgomery, in the early mid-1090s, but mountainous Arfon and remote Anglesey were still resisting. Possibly the embattled native dynast Griffith ap Cynan, Lord of Anglesey and a former but escaped prisoner of the Earl of Chester at that town, would have been a target for a campaign to secure all of Gwynedd and reinforce the precarious castles built on the coast at Rhulan and Caernarfon. William II could thus have anticipated Edward I's campaigns of 1277 and 1283-84, with less likelihood of long-term success, as by 1100, castle building had not produced such complex and secure structures as it had by the 1280s. The probability is that the Welsh would have held out inland until he ran out of supplies and had to patch up a truce, leaving the mountains, and most of the coast west of the Conwy, to them as faced invading King John in 1210. Alternatively, there were pickings in far western Divid, where the barons of the Middle Marches had penetrated to Ceredigion, Cardigan, and set up castles since the killing of King Rhys ap Toda in 1093. But would William have seen his continental French foes, fellow knights, not backward Celtic dynasts, as a more worthy foe? In the latter case, if he had taken over Normandy, the next logical targets were either Brittany, invaded by his father in 1064-65, as seen on the Bayeux tapestry, or Maine, and thence Anjou. The crucial question was whether he would have finally married and produced an heir, and if not, which brother he would have settled on as his heir. If he had deposed Robert from Normandy and imprisoned or exiled him, then Henry was a more probable heir. Robert's failure to dislodge Henry, 1101. Similarly, as of 1100 to 1106, the possibility remained that Robert would still reign as King of England by succeeding Henry on his return to Normandy. He invaded England successfully, which he had failed to do in 1088, and landed in Hampshire. He had the advice of the refugee Bishop Ranulf Flambard of Durham, William II's brutal and acquisitive chief minister, who Henry had arrested, but who had escaped from the Tower of London. He only seems to have had around 200 ships, as compared to his father's 1,000 in 1066, but this was enough to carry several thousand men, and he evaded Henry's army at Pevensey, landing safely at Portsmouth with the advantage of surprise and some time to strike before his brother arrived. It was on the cards that enough nobles would defect to him to enable him to win the conflict. He was a crusader, though Archbishop Anselm had rallied the church to Henry's side and pressurised the nobles to support him. And unlike Henry, he had recent experience of battle in the testing conditions of the Middle East. Henry's marriage to the royal Saxon heiress, Edith Matilda, was popular among the English people, arguably encouraging them to rally to his army, but led to some mockery from his nobles. Could they even have deserted him? The mass levy of the English that Henry ordered would have been ineffective if enough senior landowners, the cavalry who had won in 1066, had deserted him. The Saxon chronicler Eadmer implies that there were substantial noble desertions when Robert landed, and certainly these included Robert of Belem, head of the Montgomery dynasty, lords of Shrewsbury and the central Welsh marches, and William de Warenne of Lewis. Luckily for Henry, enough nobles remained loyal for him to meet Robert on virtually equal terms, and the latter failed to seize nearby Winchester with its treasury, possibly out of chivalry, as the Queen was in residence. The armies confronted each other east of Winchester, probably in the Meon Valley, and their near equal numbers would have made cautious nobles wary of fighting. Possibly Flambard, Robert's principal adviser, was persuaded by the offer of reinstatement by Henry, which he secured in the subsequent treaty, to talk Robert out of fighting. The stalemate was ended with a treaty at Alton, which confirmed that Robert would renounce his claim to England, but be Henry's heir if the latter had no children. A climb down, for which he has been much criticised. He threw away his best chance of securing England, whether betrayed by Flambard or not, though from the perspective of 1101, he may well have been too disappointed by his lack of English support to run a risk of defeat, when he thought he could attack again later. We have the advantage of hindsight and know the result. He ended up deprived of Normandy too, and in Henry's prisons for 28 years. But William and Robert had manoeuvred around each other warily without either achieving full success for 13 years, and Robert would have expected that there were other chances of success. As events turned out, Henry could destroy the pro-Robert faction within England in 1103, stir up trouble in Normandy, and in 1106, invade to defeat and capture his brother. William Cleto, potentially more than a footnote to history. Thereafter, the only chance of depriving Henry's line of England or Normandy lay with his brother's son, William Cleto. The name is the French equivalent of the English atheling, meaning throne-worthy, and thus indicates onlookers' belief that he was a potential successor to Henry. He was a refugee protégé of the King of France in the mid-1120s, and the French nominee to rule the neighbouring county of Flanders. His candidacy may have been suggested to Henry after the death of the latter's son and heir, William, in 1120. The succession of a female, Henry's daughter Matilda, being unprecedented in England, and Henry having no children by his new wife, Adeliza of Louvain. Some nobles seem to have backed him at the Council of 1126, which discussed the issue, and Cleto significantly received glowing praise in the Chronicle of Henry of Huntingdon, clerical deputy of Bishop Alexander of Ely, whose uncle, Bishop Roger of Salisbury, was Henry's chief minister and Matilda's foe. Did this praise imply that Alexander and Roger preferred the Cleto as the next king in 1126, and was it significant that Henry I now removed the captive Duke Robert from Bishop Roger's castle of Devizes to his own custody? The Cleto was backed by his and Henry's continental overlord, King Louis VI of France, though appointing him as heir would imply Henry's recognition that Robert had a superior claim to the throne he had usurped in 1100. But in 1127, Henry ordered an oath of loyalty to be taken to Matilda, and the Cleto did not dare to come to the king's court, but stayed in Flanders, where Henry backed the revolt of his rival Thierry of Lorraine. The Cleto's fatal wounding during a siege in July 1128 ended the possibility that he would succeed to England. If he had been alive in 1135, it is possible that the controversy over Matilda's unpopular marriage to Count Geoffrey of Anjou would have helped him to invade successfully, as it did his cousin Stephen of Bologna in real life. But it would have been politically risky for Henry to promote the Cleto as his heir, at least until Robert was dead in 1134, given the chances of the young man bearing a grudge for Robert's arrest and so staging a revolt. In a parallel case in the Eastern Roman Empire 70 years later, lackadaisical Emperor Isaac II Angelus was deposed and imprisoned by his abler brother Alexius III, 1195, who lacked a son. Isaac's son Alexius, at liberty, but politically excluded, then escaped to Western Europe to collect allies to invade his uncle's realm, resulting in the Fourth Crusade attacking the empire. Logically, the politically astute Henry could well have feared a similar fate from the Cleto. The unexpected identity of Henry I's successor. The White Ship disaster of 1120. Notably, Henry I's daughter, Matilda, born 1102, only became his heiress due to the accidental drowning of her brother, William the Atheling, on the 25th of November, 1120. The prince, probably aged 17 and recently married to his sister's future husband, Geoffrey's sister Matilda of Anjou, had been accompanying his father to the peace conference with Louis VI of France. This ended the king's contest over Normandy since 1116, and led to William doing homage to Louis as heir to Normandy. It is possible, but uncertain, that he was technically now co-ruler of the duchy and also Rex Designatus of England. The ship in which he was returning to England, the famous White Ship, loaded with junior members of the Anglo-Norman aristocracy, ran aground on rocks off the harbour due to a drunk captain and crew trying to overtake the king's own ship, according to Orderic Vitalis. Henry himself had refused to sail in her, but had given his son to the captain's care. The prince had foolishly encouraged both crew and passengers to open some casks of wine, according to Orderic, who presumably received the story via the only survivor, a Rouen butcher. The state of the drunken crew and passengers, and the unsafe number of people crowded aboard, had allegedly caused some wiser young nobles, crucially including Henry's nephew, the future King Stephen, to disembark before the ship left the harbour. Almost all of those on board were drowned. If this avoidable accident had not occurred, William would probably have succeeded to the throne of England and the Duchy of Normandy in December 1135, aged 32, and could have reigned for decades. There would have been no civil war or Angevin succession, though his Angevin wife should have provided a half-Angevin heir. Moreover, if Stephen had not been so alert, he would have drowned and thus not been available to seize the throne on his uncle's death, providing Matilda with an unchallenged succession. His elder brother Theobald was preoccupied during the County of Blois. His younger brother Henry was a cleric and so invalidated from succeeding. At the worst, if she had proved unpopular and an attempt had been made to remove her and her husband, whose Angevin dynasty was an old rival of the Normandy barons, the absence of Stephen would have meant a search for an alternative candidate. Unlike in the 11th century, English law was now more aligned to Southern European practice, and several claimants to the throne had to have a dynastic claim, which Canute and Harold Godwinson had not done. Thus, the death of Henry I's elder brother Robert's son William Cleto in 1128 left no dynastic challenger within the Norman dynasty, and the best claim lay with the descendants of Queen Margaret of Scotland. Her surviving son, King David, had strong English baronial links as husband to the heiress of Huntingdon, Earl Waltheof's daughter Matilda, the widow of Simon de Senlis, Earl of Northampton. He was an ally of Matilda, to whom he had sworn allegiance in 1128, a claim by his son Henry, heir to, and later in fiefd with Huntingdon, was possible but unlikely without David's support. The only claim outside his family would lie with any children that Stephen had had by his wife, David's sister's daughter, Countess Matilda of Boulogne. Chapter 2. Civil War. Stephen versus Matilda. The identity of the successor. Stephen's luck in being in the right place in December 1135. The Angevin era nearly began in 1135 or 1141, not 1154. If Henry I had not died when and where he did in December 1135 in southern Normandy, with Matilda, his chosen heiress, to whom he had made the magnates swear allegiance, further away from England, Anjou, than her cousin Stephen, Boulogne, Matilda could have got to England first and secured the crown. If Matilda had been in England with Henry at the time, there would have been no contest with his senior advisers, especially Bishop Roger of Salisbury, on hand to ensure that the magnates kept to their oath of allegiance to her. This would have been the case had she not remarried after the death of her first husband, Emperor Henry V, in 1125, though her father was likely to have pushed her into remarrying to gain grandchildren and heirs. She would also have been in England had she married an Anglo-Norman noble, though that would have led to jealousy of her husband by his local rivals, and King Henry was unlikely to have risked this political problem. She would have been in England too, had she been married to a younger son of a continental ally of Henry's, another possible solution for him, which did not entail her husband's county or duchy uniting with England, Normandy, as was the case when she married the Count of Anjou. But was any husband of an inferior rank, that is, non-ruling, or a younger son likely to be acceptable to Henry, or to the haughty Matilda, who may have regarded even a count, that is, Geoffrey, as socially inferior? A woman ruler was a new phenomenon to the great lords, who had expressed disquiet at Matilda being named as heir. But once William Cleto was dead, they could not threaten to transfer their allegiance to an obvious male rival. Henry does not seem to have thought of Stephen, his sister's son, as a threat. But it was not unique in Europe, as Alfonso VI's daughter, Urraca, had succeeded him in Castile and Leon in 1109. Similarly, Alfonso's illegitimate daughter, Teresa, had transmitted the dynasty's claim to the county of Portugal, then part of Castile, to her son, Afonso. In all cases, the identity of the heiress husband was of prime importance. Alfonso VI also faced his son's unexpected violent death, in battle, and, like Henry, had to adjust to his daughter being the new heir. He married off Urraca to Raymond, the brother of the Count of Burgundy, from a junior line of the Royal House of France, who moved to Castile. Like Henry, Alfonso then faced his son-in-law dying before him, and as a result, Urraca's second husband was a neighbouring ruler, King Alfonso of Aragon, 1109. This resulted in the Castilian nobles resisting Alfonso as a potential threat, just as the English and Norman nobles resisted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.